This is NDTV. And you're watching NDTV Prime. In association with Micromax. Nothing like anything.
Welcome to the Rising Stars of Comedy. I'm Akriti and Sindhu Vee. There are six things you need to know about our guest for today. She studied a lot to be a comedian. Her first comedy gig was at the age of 42. She's founded an ethical fashion website. Her friend is her worst heckler. Humor is in her genes. Okay, now wait. You might say these are just five. Well, we'll let her tell you the sixth one. Please welcome Sindhu Vee. Hello.
Hello, how are you, Akriti?
Tell us about the sixth one first.
The sixth one is definitely, I am Amitabh Bachchan's tallest Indian woman fan, without a doubt, guarantee. For sure. And Amitabh sir, are you, if you're seeing this, I just want you to know, if you could just watch one of my YouTube clips and tell me that you laughed, meri to zindagi ban jayegi.
Please welcome Sindhu Vee.
Wow, thank you. Thank you so much.
My name is Sindhu. It's obviously a name that only a Madrasi would give their kid. Almost every Punjabi I've ever met has said to me, Sandhu, ye to surname hota hai. First name kya hai? So, and now I live abroad. So obviously people there, it's even harder. They call me Cindy. They call me Sandy. They call me Shindy. And Microsoft Word autocorrect calls me Sandhog.
What pushed you into comedy?
I think it was, if I'm very honest, the immediate reason was I have three young kids and I just was feeling crazy. I was like, what can I do to really push my sanity? I'm not joking. So that was the first thing, totally out of the blue. I think on the other hand, I've always been funny and people have said you should do stand up. And I was like, who does stand up? Like, who are these people? So there was no huge thought, no big epiphany. Just got up one day and went and did it. That's it.
You were an investment banker.
I was.
Did your parents not throw a fit?
No, no, okay. First of all, I've done so many crazy different things. My parents have got tired of throwing fits. I just want to be totally honest about that. I think the second thing is also, I was an investment banker, then I stopped. Then I started an ethical fashion site.
Okay.
Then I stopped. And in between, I kept having children. And so when I finally...
She's got three.
I've got three kids. Yeah. And then, so finally, when I told them that, oh, I'm doing stand-up, they were like, okay. I mean, I was 42, so as far as my mother was concerned, I was old. I could do whatever I wanted. My father was a little concerned. You know, he kept saying, but what do you do? Do you make people laugh? And I said, yeah. And then they were like, okay. I mean, they got used to me, you know, they got used to me doing different things. Yeah, no, they didn't throw a fit. They had finished throwing their fits.
I've been a smoker my whole life. And I decided earlier this year that I have to stop. I went abroad, and that's where I really was able to smoke very freely and very openly, and it was fantastic. But for me, I realized that the smoking thing was not for my parents about kark rog. It was about kuwarapan rog. The fear was, kiski shadi nahi hogi.
A lot of your sets are on and around your mother, mm-hmm. about, you know, how she used to worry that you might not get married at one point in time, to wanting to get you settled with anybody eventually.
Pretty much.
And then worrying that you might not have kids. So according to her, you must be settled, but does she ever feel bad about featuring that much in your sets?
Not at all. Not at all. Because first of all, a lot of it is true. And my mother is a very open-hearted, larger-than-life personality. So if you know her and you watch me do comedy, you're like, yeah, I can see her saying that. So no, she doesn't mind at all. I have to be honest, a lot of stuff that I now talk about is fiction, but it's in my mother's voice. She's a very convenient character for me to play off against. No, she doesn't mind really. And I mean, there's all kinds of stuff I don't talk about on stage, which if I did, she would mind. And I still am scared of getting a chanta from her, so I don't talk about those things.
Mummy used to regularly phone people and say, "Haan haan, Sindhu to 5'8 hai, aap rishta bhej dijiye." I would say, "Mummy, main to 5'10 hu." "Chup raho, koi ladki 5'10 nahi hoti." I said, "Lekin aapne to kal hi napa hai." From the time I was 5'7, my mother used to napo me every 2 months. "Aapne kal hi to napa hai." "Are to broadcast karne ki kya zarurat hai, ladke wale dar ke bhag jayenge." "Are to jab kal aayenge to khud hi dekh lenge." "Nahi nahi, tum na sofa pe jaake baith jana aur tum uthna hi mat." "Lekin baith hi rehna." The other thing was my chashma. "Ye tumne chashme kyun pehen rakhe hain, ladke wale aane wale utaro." "But I can't see without them." "Are tumhe kya dekhna hai, ladka tumhe dekhne aa raha hai." "But nahi nahi, tum na sofa pe baithi rehna, kuch mat kehna aur koi tumse koi baat kare kehna, "Haan ji, I am a very homely girl." "Haan ji, I'm a very homely girl." And I put my foot down. I said, "Mummy, main nahi bolungi homely, it means ugly." She said, "Nahi nahi, India mein homely ka matlab girl who makes a nice home. Kehna, I am very homely. Main nahi bolungi homely." "Theek hai, jhaado apni angrezi. Yahi haal raha na, to 50 saal ki baanj kuwari dhonda ban ke reh jaogi. Market jaogi, log hasenge." It was a very small step from my mother, from me keeping my chashma on, to becoming a 50-year-old, barren, unmarried, what is dhonda? Freaky giant.
Was it tough? Because, you know, you obviously come from a mixed lineage of your father being a Tamilian, your mother being a UP, born and brought up woman. Was there ever too much to handle sort of a situation in your childhood?
Looking back, I can say the question, was there ever too much? I think it's like, when was there never too much? Because they're both very much from their cultures. So I think as a child, you just adapt. So I had this idea that when I went to the South, I was very South Indian, and it helped that I looked like my father. And I was very short for a long time. I suddenly grew tall. So if I'd been this tall in South India, it would not have worked. And when I was in UP, I grew up in Lucknow.
Okay.
So, you know, when I was in UP, I was like a North Indian kid. It wasn't really a big deal then. It's only later that I realized how much of an outsider my sister and I always were.
For one thing, from the time I was born, and I could understand language, not that I could understand language when I was born, but I was born and then some years later I could understand language, I used to hear that Sindhu's complexion is wheatish. Dark? No. Wheatish. Now, my mother is from UP, and she's doodh jitni safed, and very proud of it. So to call me dark was to invite her to commit suicide, basically. I remember once my mausi said, "Hai, ye Sindhu to kuch kali reh gayi." My mother didn't come out of her bedroom for 4 days. And we didn't meet the mausi for a decade.
Tell us about your first gig.
Oh boy.
Where was it?
Yeah, okay, so my first gig was kind of strange because it was a... it was the Heats for the Funny Women Awards in 2012. Okay. And I had been resisting going to the Heats because for me, the idea that you would go and do stand-up was just wildly disassociated with anything I had ever done. So but I agreed, and I assumed that it would be in front of the judges who had run the workshop. So, you know, I would go into a room, I would tell a few funny stories, and that would be it.
Okay.
I pitched up there. I didn't tell anyone in my family, nobody. I pitched up there. At the last minute, I asked a friend to come because I thought, well, you know, what if I freak out? I'll need someone afterwards to have a drink with, or several drinks. And it was a bar. It was a bar open to the public. And I was like, what is this? And that was it. And the organizer, she came up to us and she said, right, this is the lineup. I didn't know what a lineup was. She said, and you need a 5-minute set.
Okay.
And I said, set of what? Like, that's how much I knew. Yeah. She was like, what you're going to see on stage, it's called a set. I was like, okay. And I just waited in the wings. And then when they called my name, I just went and picked up the mic and started talking. I have to say, it was surreal. It was surreal, but it was a lot of fun. And if I had known any more about it, I probably wouldn't have showed up. I kind of deluded myself into doing it. And that was the first gig. It went really well. People laughed. I spoke Hindi, I spoke Danish. It was ridiculous. I mean, I just did whatever. And it worked really well. And I made it to the semi-final, so obviously.
Okay, for the lack of a better word, do you remember anything you said that night?
Oh, yes, definitely. I asked a lady in the front in Danish whether she was Danish. And I scared the pants off her because you don't look at me and think, oh, she's going to talk Danish. I remember that very clearly. And I also remember I told a story about my mother, who was worried that because I wasn't getting married, I might be lesbian. So I remember that very clearly. Those are the two things. I also remember feeling like, I actually remember telling myself, they're just your friends. It's like you're telling your friends a story. But those are two things I said on the night that I remember very clearly.
My husband is Danish, from Denmark. And the reason I'm clarifying Danish from Denmark is when I told my mother that he's Danish, she said, "Tumhara dimag to sahi hai, wo to America mein nashte mein dete hain."
My mother is also motivated me in her own way. A couple of months ago, I was very nervous about getting on stage and I thought I couldn't do it. And I called her and I said, "Ma, you know, I don't know about mojo. Ye jojo kaun hai?" She said, "Nahi, mojo." "Acha bhai, mojo kaun hai?" "Nahi, mummy, it's not that. It's like your juice, your funniness, your..." "Are, shut up. Jab se you are 2 years old, you are like a joker."